You are seeing on your screen two pictures, one of a dark-colored English peppered moth, one of a light-colored English peppered moth. This is presented in many textbooks as an example of evolution taking place so that you can see it. And here's how the scenario supposedly goes. Before the Industrial Revolution, when there were light-colored lichens that grew on tree trunks, then the moth population was 95% light-colored because they blended in with the lichens on the tree trunks. And the moth population was 5% dark-colored because they didn't blend in. And the idea was, if you are a bird and you approach a tree and there's a dark-colored moth that doesn't blend in with the tree and there's a light-colored moth that does, which one will you eat? Well, obviously, you'll eat the one that is not camouflaged, that doesn't blend in. You'll eat the black, darker-colored moth, and that's why there were only 5% of those. Well, they said, after the Industrial Revolution, when soot and smoke were dumped into the atmosphere, the lichens were killed, and the tree trunks on which these English peppered moths land turned black and dark. And guess what happened to the English peppered moth population? Well, it shifted so that 95% of the English peppered moths were the new darker color, not a new color necessarily, but just a greater percentage of them, and only 5% were the lighter color. And they said this is an example of evolution in action. In fact, some of them said it's the best example of evolution that we've got. Don't think that this is not used often in textbooks. This is a textbook that Eric Lyons showed you in a previous lecture, Evolution Change Over Time. On page 61, I want to read to you the statement made about the English peppered moth, and there are two pictures similar to the ones on your screen, and here's the statement made. After the start of the Industrial Revolution, the light gray bark of trees was darkened by the soot from factories. In each photograph, which peppered moth would most likely be noticed by a hungry bird? Now, think about that. Is this an example of evolution in action? Some people say it's one of the best ones we've got. All right? Now, we're going to do some critical thinking. I know that if you do some critical thinking, it's not what people want you to do in regard to stuff that supposedly proves evolution. Before the Industrial Revolution, you had the genetic components and makeup that would produce in the English peppered moth two variations, light-colored and dark-colored. After the Industrial Revolution, you had the genetic makeup and components that would produce in the English peppered moth two variations, dark-colored and light-colored. So the English peppered moth evolved into, drum roll please, the English peppered moth. Did it evolve into half moth, half bird? Did it evolve into a moth with half wings and some scales? No. It evolved into nothing. It evolved from the English peppered moth into the English peppered moth. It didn't evolve anywhere. It started the English peppered moth and it ended the English peppered moth. But that's not what's so disturbing about this particular illustration. What's so disturbing about this particular illustration is that English peppered moths, they don't land on tree trunks. They've been studying for 40 years. From what I can ascertain, they've only ever found two on tree trunks. Now, the pictures that you see in the textbooks are of English peppered moths on tree trunks. The caption that I just read talked about the English peppered moths being on tree trunks. How did the English peppered moths get on the tree trunks in the pictures in the textbooks that are used all over the country? Oh, they pinned some of them there. Or they caught them and artificially placed them on the trees. You see, English peppered moths move at night. And they land under the leaves of trees and not on the tree trunks. Well, you would like to think, okay, maybe the textbook writers and the people who are putting these pictures in didn't know this information. Maybe it was inadvertently put in there, although they just weren't aware of it. No, it's not the case. If you'll look at the bottom of your screen, you'll realize that the quotes I'm about to read to you are from Bob Ritter, a Canadian textbook writer who knew that the English peppered moth pictures were staged. Here's what he says. He says, well, you got to look at the audience. I mean, how convoluted do you want to make it for a first-time learner? Then he says, the advantage of this example of natural selection is that it's extremely visual. Now stop right there. Suppose I've got a theory. Oh, it's my little pet theory, and I believe that it really happened. I believe that white cows, when they eat green grass, grow purple spots. And I say, guys, I've got a theory. What do you think of it? You say, Kyle, well, we'd have to see some evidence for that. And I said, well, of course. Everyone needs evidence to back up a theory. So I said, just go outside with me and look at this herd of white cows that I have. And I took you outside and you saw 10 or 12 white cows that I have. And I said, if you'll notice what they're eating, after lunch you will see they're eating green grass, but after lunch it only takes a few hours for those purple spots to pop up. After lunch, I'm just going to invite you guys to come back out to this herd of cows, and I want you to see if they've grown purple spots. And after lunch, sure enough, you walk out there and you see all 12 of those cows are covered with purple spots. And I ask you a simple question, what were they eating before lunch? You say green grass. Another simple question, what do they have now on their bodies? Purple spots. And one of you walks over to one of those cows and you put your hand on the side of that cow, and as you take your hand back, you notice that some of that purple comes off on your hand. And you pull a handkerchief out and you wipe one of those purple spots and you wipe the entire spot off. And you realize that those spots are painted on there. And you come up to me and you say, Kyle, those cows didn't grow those spots, you painted them. And I said, I know, but it's extremely visual, isn't it? You can really see it. Well, yeah, you can see it. Because if you get to make up the information that supposedly proves a theory, and then when it's shown to be false, you say, yeah, but we use it because you can see it so well. Well, look at this next statement. He says, we want to get across the idea of selective adaptation. Later on, they can look at the situation more critically. You ever stop to think when later on is? Did you know later on's not in middle school, because in the middle school textbooks it's filled with stuff like this English peppered moth. Later on's not in the high school textbooks. Did you know later on's not in the college textbooks, because the college textbooks have this same material in them supposedly proving evolution? When is later on? One of the gentlemen involved in looking at this evidence had a PhD before he ever saw the fault of the English peppered moth scenario. When is later on? It is the sad case that many times later on simply means if a child or a teenager has the chance to view some material from a creationist organization that points out the flaws of this type of information. And that is the sad state of later on.